it's about, like, for now, like, trying to make my own program to get to these races first off, because it takes a lot to get to these races. I got a shop behind me now, which is really cool. New brand. We kind of started off strong this year, kind of ran into some health issues, a couple bike problems, but I think I've been learning a lot. I know what the sport's all about, so it's just pretty much coming down to, how I can make my program better to get to these races and try to work to what I deserve and what my goal is.
Okay, guy in your early 20s, 22, 23?
Yeah, I just turned 23 in May, so okay. Still got some time, still chasing the dream. We're going for it, man. We're here. We're trying. But there's always something, but that's just how it goes. So we're just rolling with the punches, and we're gonna get it done. We'll get noticed.
So as a guy that, you know, in talking to you, talking to your dad, doing Vincent's Concrete, having the support that you guys have, having a real life back home in PA, and then coming back to race the races, how is it to find the balance of everything?
That's the hardest part, because waking up every day, you just do the old, scroll through the phone thing. Everybody that I'm pretty much racing, there's some other privateer guys in the same situation, but for the most part, everybody in the circuit's kind of able to wake up, train, ride, and that's pretty much it. So I train really hard all the time, kind of, whenever we're not racing, but it seems like when racing comes with work, the hardest part for me is trying to manage, don't overwork yourself. I can easily overdo my body, because I try to, we get up, we go to work, come home, try to train, and then you feel like crap, and then you try to ride, and then the next day you're just dead. So the biggest thing for me is trying to just believe in my strength and ability, and my ability on the bike. And if I can't ride that week, I just gotta kind of stay calm, try to get a little bit of cardio in if I can. And just try not to overthink it, and try not to compare myself to everybody else's style, just because that's what I got right now,
The work that you do, super physical stuff, how does that impact your riding? Do you feel like maybe I'm stronger in a place that a guy that's just riding a bicycle and doing gym work maybe would never understand?
I feel like the only thing that it benefits me is up here and here, because I don't feel any... I feel like, honestly, it breaks your body down, because you're not getting cardio. I mean, it's obviously strength, but it breaks your body down more, and just gets you to where you're just tired and you feel like crap, and it breaks your back, all that good stuff. Ask Big Vince, he'll tell you. But
you're using the pro, yeah. the first qualifier he's been using for practice, because he hasn't ride.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that happens a good bit. It's a little stressful, but I try, like I said, that's why I try to believe in my ability and just to be confident enough to just say, hey, that's what I had to do this week. I got my bike ready, I'm here, and that's it. But
track's closed down by our house.
Yeah, no, we're ripping in my trails, just trying to get any kind of riding in, No, for real, we are. He's going up there in his old 03 Polaris making trails in the weeds, and I'm out there ripping. I'd probably be a GNCC fucking champion. 100%.
Spider, man. I got more spider bites on me than you ever had.
But no, it's all part of the journey, though. I mean, I wouldn't do it if I didn't believe in myself and didn't believe that I deserved to be in a rig. So it's kind of all the journey and just trying to, get my little program together to where I can make more rounds. And I'm still kind of doing that. So.
Okay. I like it, though, dude. I like the realistic approach to it. You know what you got to do. You understand everything that is working against you, but the things that you got to not let frustrate you or beat you down too much, and then just keep it going forward. So then when you get to come to the races, like your dad said, first practice is your real practice for the weekend. How long does it take you to get into the zone and be like, all right, let's do it, let's do the shit today?
Well, that's the bit that's been my whole problem, is the qualifying's always been my biggest problem, because I'm really good in the motos, because I kind of find my groove, and my conditioning is always good, so I always get faster throughout. So it's always been about not looking pretty and going out there and just kind of hammering down. My dad's always telling me, because it comes down to tenths here, so it's hard to try to just go out there. And I learned, instead of rolling around, there's so many strategies, so many different ways you can approach qualifying. But for me, I used to try to get my own space and go slow that first lap, but I learned, hey, you don't have much time, and you gotta fill out the bike and everything. Like, I try to use my first lap to at least bank into some stuff and try to get some kind of warm up, because that first practice is where it's all at. And a couple of these rounds this year, I struggled because I just really didn't have that like intensity and comfort that I needed, or some shock adjustments that I needed to make that just weren't, you know, available or wasn't able to figure out. But no, I think I got it pretty much figured out now, later in the season, unfortunately. But I think we'll be ready to go tomorrow, though, for sure.
You know, taking a look at your bike right now, just even as the 10-foot glance that I have of it, the extra clamps, but then you have Racetech WP suspension, you have a heart rate monitor up there on the handlebars. You know what you need to do. This is no, like, second-guessing.
Oh, no.
You know the little things that you need to do, a recluse clutch that I see. So how is it then for you to figure out a bike to your own settings? I mean, you could have just left the stock stuff on there, like on your practice bike, but you want it to be the best it could be.
Yeah, so 450, that's why I'm racing a 450 class, because you don't really have to do much to the motor. It's more just like chassis stuff. So I've always liked these X-Tricks just because, like, they flex more. I've been learning a little bit more about the steering of those, like about how they turn and whatever. But no, I mean, I know what I need. Just a couple things. That's why I like the 450. It's because you have more of a chance. The 250, you got to try to do everything you can, and then you pretty much know it's still not comparable. So with the 450, my budget, I was able to focus on my chassis a little bit more and sell some things that I had from last year to kind of put into this. But yeah, some of it worked out, and some of it I've been struggling with. But I think right now, I think I got it pretty decent, so I'm excited for tomorrow.
So before we started talking, you and your dad explaining how you guys have learned certain things for the years, like tested some stuff out, things that you thought you wanted, things that you find out maybe don't work for you. How is it to see how the industry really is? Because I think so many people have a perception of it, some negative, some positive, and all of these things, how they go. But now you've seen it and you still want to come back and you still want to get to a rig. Where is it from your spot right now?
Yeah, so I mean, growing up, obviously, is like the old school, the Great Outdoor DVDs. Like, that's what I grew up watching. It was the coolest, like, old school. Obviously, a lot of things have changed. Strategies for us have changed just because we've been, you know, chasing the 250 class, and just the motors they have and all the technologies. It's just really hard to compete with, especially with a budget. So, you know, that's why this 450 class came into the picture. We've seen some other privateer guys doing it, and it works. I mean, they try to say, you know, the 250 class, blah, blah, blah. Like, you know, if you do better or not, then, you get noticed more. But, I mean, I've seen it go both ways. So just from experience of watching over the years, some people doing better in a 450 just because of that reason of having a little bit more equal bike. That's why I'm here. But, no, I mean, we know how it all is. We know the advantages and disadvantages, but that just motivates us to come here and do our best and fight these dudes, you know.
To do it on your own, the way that you're doing it too, just looking at the bike.
Paying for all that himself.
Yeah, I can imagine that. And then also the sponsors that you have. Yeah, some, you know, mainstream moto sponsors, but then you have really, really core people that are behind you too. True MX, and then local people like Joseph Hughes Construction, you and your dad's construction or concrete company. The people that are there, man, how is it to go approach them and let them know, hey, this is what I'm doing, this is how we're going about it, how do you want to get down and help us?
Yeah, I mean, the people that I have, they're really loyal, and it's very, you know, hometown, like Christopher's Pizza and the Stubbs Lady and everybody, Ryan, Jerry M Tech, like Fast Track Moto, Jason, like everybody knows where I'm at, and they've all been really good to me and been trying to help me any way they can. Just small people, just, you know, just seeing me trying my best, and they're trying to help me any way they can. So I look forward to working with all them too, and hopefully you know, branching out and trying to gain some more sponsors for Supercross, you know, and just keep the ball rolling. But no, I got a lot of great people with me right now.
When you like you said, when you watched the Great Outdoors videos back in the day, was there a guy that was in them that you really resonated with? Like, I can think of you and Robbie Raynard really matching up right now out of the van with your dad here. I think that's pretty cool.
Oh, I loved all of them. Like Pastrana, like I loved watching Pastrana. Like the DVD I had, like he was doing hill clickers, and he was like 12 over his pond and stuff like that. Like those, Carmichael. Stewart, all them guys. Like, it was just like the grueling days. Like, it was just, that's what I love. Like, I love like the hot motos, like late whenever you're tired. Like, obviously, like it's sucking in the moment, like you're suffering, but like I enjoy that for some reason. It's weird, but like I just feel like I'm in the heart and soul of the outdoor motocross, you know what I mean? So, but no, I truly, we love the sport. My dad loves it, and we have fun doing it and chasing the dream. So, I mean, I have the ability. It's just down to, you know, getting into this industry with these people and getting my program good enough to where I can come in and put in his results that I'm trying to get. So,
okay, you and your dad coming around. You have the Sprinter van right now, and you just told me it used to be that you guys would take a construction truck, and there'd be stuff. You go to the job site Monday, and stuff wouldn't be there. How fun is it to do it with your dad? Because I'm sure there's times where you guys just want to kill each other.
Oh yeah,
but there's other times where you're like, yeah, man, there's nobody else I'd rather do this with than him, and I'm sure it's the same way for him too.
Yeah, I mean, we've been doing it forever. He knows a lot. He's like a DeCoster Jr., but he reads up all the time and everything. So, no, it's awesome. I mean, having this van I'm able to drive, we get here probably 3 hours quicker because he likes to drive 20 mile an hour. But he does the old, I'll be like, hey, man, come on. Like, we're going 50. He's like, hey, man, I just want to get us here. And then we get here, he does his old school, cracks his beer, and says, man, I'm just glad we made it. Like, things like that. You know, he's a legend. If anyone knows my dad, which most people do, he's a legend. And no, so we enjoy it. He's slowing down a little bit, but he enjoys it. He's still the same and all that. But no, the van, we painted it with house paint over the winter. I bought it in Pittsburgh, had some surface rust, but it's awesome. Low miles, diesel. It was what I always wanted, so that's coming together and that's gonna pay off. It already is in these past few rounds since how much gas is and everything right now. So no, he's been a huge help my whole life, and my van and all that stuff, just life lessons, bike stuff, everything. So no, he'll be here till we can't. So as long as there's a pizza around, he'll be here.
How is it to watch your boy?
Oh, it's great. I love watching him. And then just when I could just see when things are going wrong, like if something breaks on the bike, or he keeps going. You know, he was in that pileup last week, the first turn. I was like, are you kidding me? He just got off COVID. And then he got back on his bike. He finished the race, you know, just to finish the race. And then he went out the next moto, all banged up and stuff. And next thing you know, his clutch basket broke. But he finished the moto, got down in the 20s. And that just makes me mad. But we fixed it. Here we are again.
Here we are again.
I think that's a resounding theme for a lot of parents in here. A lot of those amateur kids that I've been watching today, I'm like, there they are again. Looking at the setup you have, I mean, you know what it takes to make a moto van. You got the power washer, the generator, microwave, Keurig.
Yeah, we still.
The Keurig is a must. It is.
I love that one.
Yeah.
But yeah, dude, it's cool. Like, I mean, you know what it takes to go out there after being a lifetime motorcycle rider. You know what it takes to put it together and then to come rough it for a weekend.
Yeah, it's starting, like, you can tell, like, it's about, like, so we'd bring that camper and stuff. It was such a drag. Like, it's not like Loretta Lynn's anymore, or you're not staying there for a week. So it's kind of like the smaller and more convenient, the better. That way you can kind of get in and out deal, you know what I mean? So that's
money,
been a...
Money.
Yeah, and that all saves big. So that's all been changing. You know, we've been changing with the way it all is and everything, and it's going. It's good. Still got some shelves not to build, but it'll be good.
Another winter project. It's getting ready to get cold. Okay, last question. You've been here for a bit. You've ridden forever. You see all of the stuff that's going on. What is the, like, five-year plan right now? Is it just kind of still waiting to see how things shake up, or do you have a concrete plan that you want to follow? And then when it's all said and done, how much fun is it just to be what you are right now? Just to know, as a guy in your early 20s, you're fast as hell. You get to go race. You can go hold your own against some of the best guys in the world. You know, yeah, it does cost you to do it, but, I mean, what else would you go do?
I mean, right now, I'm chasing a dream. I mean, I know I have a little bit of time left. I know it ain't going to last forever. So I feel like my, well, five-year plan, well, if I can cut that down a little bit shorter, I know my next few years, I have a little bit more time to kind of put everything I have into this and really try to get to where I feel like I should be, because I feel like once I can get there, then I'll be good. But I'll give it my all these next few years, and then obviously you know, after that, if things don't work out, I'm still gonna do it. I'm gonna do this for as long as I can. It's in my blood. It's what I do. If I don't get the ride, or if I don't get the race for a while, I just don't feel like myself. You know what I mean? Like, this is what I do. So I'll always race. But, you know, might have to work, and I don't know about the concrete. I don't. I'm good at it, and you can make money, but I tell you what, man, I don't want to do it.
I don't want to be a concreter, man.
I don't. I mean, it kills your knees and your back, and it just isn't what I want to do.
Yeah, respect to you guys that do it. I have a lot of friends that do it. Anybody that does, like, general contracting and that stuff, you see it when you get to 40, 50. You guys are bad dudes.
Oh, yeah, it's bad.
It's bad. Dude, they're rough. I mean, you might have, you know, the $80,000 truck, but beat up, yeah. Last thing, how fun is tomorrow? When you're sitting on the starting line, the gate's about to drop, how is that in the moment for you?
That's, like, the best feeling in the world. Like, I literally look around. I take it all in. Like, I'm looking around. Like, when you fire our bikes up, the girl goes by with the card. I'm trying to focus. He's like, check her out. I'm like, no, man. I'm like, she's pretty, but no, man. I'm trying to focus. This is it. First of all, he's yelling, all right, man, this is it, everything, fight. 2 seconds later, dude, check her out. I'm like, what the heck?
That'll make you happy.
Yeah, that's what he says. He goes, that'll make you happy. That'll make you go faster. I'm like, no, no, no. But anyway, I look out. I look at everybody. I'm like, you know, I'm like, you know, I'm here. This is it. Getting ready to drop the gate, the fastest dudes in the world. And that psychs me up. I love it. Now, that's the best feeling in the world. I can't wait for tomorrow. This is what we do. This is why I have this van and everything.
A little stick of a picture of Shakira out there on a fishing string. He has to chase it like
this.
And then he'll go fast.
Heck yeah, boys. I love it.
Oh, man.
Have fun tomorrow.
Thank you. Appreciate it.